On the first day of October, 1891, after 6 years of planning and building, Leland Stanford Junior University opened its doors to its first class of eager students. About 2,000 chairs had been set up in the 3-acre central quad, which soon would be overflowing with people. A founding faculty member recalled, "Hope was in every heart, and the presiding spirit of freedom prompted us to dare greatly." The university was a gift from the Stanfords, given in memory of their son, Leland Jr., who died at age 15. Leland Sr. was 67 when the school opened. He had been a Western pioneer, a railroad magnate, California's Civil War governor, and a U.S. senator. He drove the Golden Spike into the track near Ogden, Utah, linking the Central Pacific Railroad Company, of which he was president, with the westward-building Union Pacific. To serve as the campus, Stanford endowed his university with more than $20 million, including 8,800 acres of his stock farm. Today, the school is affectionately called The Farm. The Stanford selected Dr. David Starr Jordan to be the university's first president. Jordan was serving as president of the University of Indiana when the senator and Mrs. Stanford came to call, delivered to Bloomington in their private railroad car. Jordan accepted the Stanford's offer. He was president of the university for 21 years. Jordan was responsible for recruiting a large part of Stanford's pioneer faculty. He lured outstanding teachers from Cornell University and other eastern campuses, creating a high-powered science and engineering faculty that was to be the school's hallmark.
I think the philosophy here has always been, I mean, way back before Terman to the time of David Starr Jordan, the philosophy here has been that if you have a good idea and it has some potential for accomplishing human benefit, you ought to get it out there where it can be of practical use. This is a place that was formed at the time when the West was still a frontier. Practical knowledge was highly valued. Senator Stanford valued it highly. And the university has always had an affection for application as well as theory.
The first really enterprise here was the old Mackey radio. And that was started by a guy named Cyrus Elwell. And he started this company, bought the patents, came back and raised the capital while he was here. It's interesting that David Starr Jordan encouraged some of his faculty to buy this stock. So you might say that he was the first venture capitalist.
Jordan, then president of the university, put up $500 of his own money for Elwell's company and urged other faculty members and investors to do the same. Elwell initially called his firm the Polson Wireless Telephone and Telegraph Company, but a year later changed the name to the Federal Telegraph Company. Within 2 years, Federal had become one of the largest firms of its kind in the country. In 1932, the company moved to New Jersey as Federal Electric and is today part of ITT. DeForest was in San Francisco in 1911 to supervise the installation of his company's Audion-based telegraph units on two U.S. Army transport ships, when he learned that one of the officers of his company had drained the treasury and left him broke and in debt. With no hope of saving his company, DeForest joined Elwell's company in Palo Alto. A year after he joined Federal Telegraph, DeForest was arrested by federal marshals for stock fraud. He and the other officers of his failed New York firm were charged with deliberately misleading investors about a queer little bulb, which was supposed to make it possible for people to talk with each other across the Atlantic Ocean. Federal put up the $10,000 that kept DeForest out of jail until his trial, and he was later acquitted, though several officers of the company did go to prison. 3 years later, engineers of the American Telephone and Telegraph Company used DeForest's queer little bulb to send radio messages from Arlington, Virginia, to the Eiffel Tower in Paris. DeForest's invention opened the way for a host of inventions, from radio and television to radar and long-distance telephony, and earned him the title Father of Electronics. Federal Telegraph may be considered to be Silicon Valley's first incubator of startup companies. In 1913, two federal employees, Peter Jensen and E.S. Pridham, left their jobs to start their own enterprises in the Napa wine country north of San Francisco. They invented the loudspeaker and founded a company called Magnavox. Meanwhile, just a few miles away, a self-taught electronics genius from Idaho was developing a device to focus and deflect an electron beam electromagnetically. Philo Farnsworth would first demonstrate his device in San Francisco in 1927. It was the first all-electronic transmission of a picture and became the basis for television.